Good evening, everyone. Mark Meckler here for Citizens for Self-Governance and Convention of States. I'm really excited to be with all of you tonight. We've got a lot of people logging on, so I'm going to give it a few minutes for everybody to get logged on and get started. The response to this, when we put this out that we were going to do this video broadcast, was really overwhelming. I mean, we actually figured, you know, if we got 500 people or so who signed up, we'd be pretty excited to get that kind of response to our first live video hangout on air. And we've never used this technology before. We've never done this before, so we didn't know what would happen. At last count, when I went and looked at it, we had something like 3,300. We'll probably be upwards of 3,500 people by the time we get going tonight. So really extraordinary. And I think that kind of excitement indicates the excitement for Convention of States. And the reason I say that and the reason I think it's so amazing right now is because there's a thirst in this country for what we should do, right? And so people want to know, we have these great elections, we're really excited about what happened, but what do we do next? And the answer to what we do next is what we're going to talk about tonight. We're going to talk about why, and we're going to talk about the what's and the how's and what the election meant for all of us. You know, we know what it meant in standard electoral terms, but the question is, what did it mean for us really for Convention of States? What did it really mean for the future of the country? So I'm watching the clickers, people sign on. We still have a lot of people signing on here. Give you a little background. This is coming to you live from my home in Northern California. I live up in the mountains. A lot of you guys, I know when you think of California, you think of crazy liberal California. California, if you look at it geographically versus demographically, politically, the geography lays out where you have the major metro areas, San Francisco and LA, primarily very, very left-leaning, and those dominate the state's politics. I mean, the two of the largest metro areas in the United States of America, so they really dominate our state's politics. If you look at the map, by the way, the geography lays out politically, you probably got about 80-85% of the state that is red. It's extraordinary. So we have conservative California, we have liberal California. I live in kind of a mixed area, but more conservative, I would say. I live up in the hills, sort of directly between Sacramento, California, and Lake Tahoe, California. It's a beautiful, beautiful place in the country. Used to be when I traveled around the country and I'd tell people that I live in California, I remember this 20 years ago, and they would look at me longingly. And they would say that, usually say something like, oh, I've always wanted to live there. I've visited. It's so wonderful. It's so beautiful. What an incredible place, the Golden State, all that stuff. Today, when I travel the country like I do so often, and somebody asks me where I'm from, and I say California, I get the, I'm sorry about that. Why don't you move here? Wherever I am, almost, people are saying I should move there, because the truth is most places in the country, politically speaking, are a lot better off than California. I just saw our business rankings. We currently rank 48th out of 50, and behind us only New York and New Jersey. So, you know, we're at the bottom of the list where we really belong. Economically, we belong at the top, but politically, we definitely belong at the bottom. So I'm watching a lot of people still signing on, so I'm just going to do a couple more minutes of introduction. I'll tell you a little bit about myself for those of you who don't know me. Yeah, I came to politics 6 years ago via the Tea Party movement. I was not politically active before then, like probably so many of you that are watching this tonight, and I'd always paid attention to politics. I thought they were fun. I kind of watched them like a sport. You know, I had this idea that there was my team, and then there was the other team, and a good election was like my team winning the Super Bowl, and it was kind of the same in that then it went into the off season, right? The Super Bowl's over, especially the presidential election's like a Super Bowl, and then I go relax, and most of the voters would go relax and not pay attention to politics as a quote-unquote sport until the next season, until the next election season. I learned, or I came to realize back in 2009 when the Tea Party movement started, that politics wasn't really a sport anymore, that it had become about the survival of the nation as I know it, about our ability to pass on to our kids and our grandkids the nation that we know and love, or something very diminished and something much less than what I grew up in and so many people on this call grew up in. And so I got really serious back in 2009. I started participating in the Tea Party movement at the very beginning. I ended up holding a Tea Party event back in early 2009, February 2009, in the first round of Tea Parties. There were 35 of us around the country that did this. We held Tea Parties, and we didn't know what would happen. About 39,000 people came out nationwide. I was really inspired. I came home to my house here in the foothills. I decided that I wanted to do more. I didn't know what to do. I ended up networking with people in California and all over the country. And ultimately, five of us came together and started what was called Tax Day Tea Party, decided we were going to do another Tea Party event on April 15, 2009. Now, that's the Tea Party event that most people in America know about, because ultimately, citizens stood up in over 850 cities around the nation, held Tea Party events. We estimate about 1.2 million people took to the streets that day, February 27, 2009. And at that point, that made that the largest multi-city simultaneous protest in literally world history. So that's how I got my start in politics. In the Tea Party movement, I ended up building up Tea Party Patriots with my co-founders. That ultimately had came to the point where it had 3,200 chapters around the country, about 23 million members, roughly, we estimate. And about 2.5 years ago, I decided to leave the organization. And I left for a couple of reasons, but one of the big ones was, as I traveled around the country, I realized that the Tea Party movement as a brand had reached its zenith. In other words, while people still love the Tea Party, it had been vilified so much on television and so much by politicians that what ultimately happened is I would say to people, do you believe in constitutionally limited government? Do you believe in free markets? You know, do you believe in the principles of the Tea Party? And they would say yes. And then I would say, oh, you must be a Tea Partier. And they would say, absolutely not. And so I realized there was a chance to expand these ideas, these fundamental American ideas that most of us believe in, well beyond the brand of the Tea Party movement. And that's why I started Citizens for Self-Governance. You know, I realized that my friends and my neighbors who didn't self-identify as conservatives, they actually shared a lot of my values. And so I wanted to remove this idea that it had to be Tea Party and talk about the ideas instead. And so that's why we formed Citizens for Self-Governance. Now, about a year and a half ago, Michael Ferris came to me and talked to me about this idea of this crazy thing he called the Convention of States. And I got to be honest with you, I was a little bit skeptical at first. I mean, I knew about Article 5. I knew about the idea that we, the sovereign citizens of this country, had the right to call an amending convention and propose amendments to the Constitution. And I liked the idea in principle. I like the idea of citizens taking control. That's what I'm all about as a grassroots guy, citizens being in charge. But when I first heard about it a couple of years ago, before I talked to Mike Ferris, I was at a conference that I co-hosted at Harvard with a law professor there at Harvard, just talking about the idea of an Article 5 convention. I was pretty neutral on the idea, mainly because I didn't believe we could actually get it done. You know, I thought it would be great if we could, but that there were so many important things we were working on in America right then that really we shouldn't waste our energy on holding a convention. And then Michael Ferris came along, and for those of you who have met him, you know what an inspiring man he is, literally kind of like the founding fathers come to life in the modern days, done so much incredible stuff in this country, founded the Homeschool Legal Defense Association, really helped to make homeschool legal all across the country when it was under assault in America, one of the few men in America ever to argue an Article 5 case before the Supreme Court, founder and chancellor of Patrick Henry College. So this is a guy I took seriously, and he came to me with Convention of States, and the thing that he told me that was most important was not about the idea, it was about the idea that we could actually get it done. And he had a plan for getting it done. And when he told me the plan, it made perfect sense to me. And basically what he said to me is, Mark, do you realize that all we need is 100 volunteers in each state legislative district who are willing to call or write to their state legislature and let that person know that we want them to call a Convention of States? And I thought, really? Really? Just 100? I mean, that seemed like a small number coming from a Tea Party perspective. And, you know, I also knew Mike Ferris had the whole homeschool network. So we thought between the two of us that we could actually get this done. And that's really what got me so excited, the idea that we could get it done. Now, I want to back up for a second because I know there are some people who are with us tonight that don't necessarily know what an Article 5 amending convention is exactly. They don't understand the process. So I want to just give you sort of a brief overview of the process and how the whole thing works. And it's pretty simple. If you look at the second clause of Article 5 in the Constitution, which is one of the shortest clauses in the Constitution anyway, the second clause is very short. It's where we get the right as citizens working through 2/3 of our states or 34 states to call a convention for proposing amendments to the United States Constitution. All that has to happen is the majority in each house of the legislature in 34 states says we want to hold such a convention, and the convention gets called. Congress has one duty and one duty only in that convention, that is to set the time and place for the convention. It's ministerial. They don't even have a choice. And frankly, our position is once we get to 34 states, they can call it or not. If they don't call it right away, then we're just going to get together with the states and we're going to call it. You know, as we like to say, our attitude is we don't need no stinking Congress. Because the whole point of Article 5 is to go around Congress. The point is, when you have an intransigent Congress, an intransigent president and court system, the people get together through the mechanism of the states and call an Article 5 convention to propose amendments. It's interesting how this came into being. You know, when you go back and you look at the history of the first convention, the 1787 Constitutional Convention, 2 weeks ago in that convention, George Mason stood up and he noticed a glaring inadequacy in the Constitution. What he noticed is that somewhere in the drafting process, they had dropped out the ability for citizens to propose amendments through the states. What they had only was a way for Congress to propose. And Mason said something very wise and profound. I'm going to paraphrase here. I'm sure not as eloquently as he could. But he said, basically, are we so naive that we would believe that a Congress that has become tyrannical would propose such amendments as would restrain its own tyranny? I mean, it seems pretty obvious that's never going to happen. It's not going to happen today. Congress isn't going to restrain itself. The president clearly isn't going to restrain himself, no matter who's in office. And so it's up to the people. And in fact, in 1787, there in the last 2 weeks of that convention, that wisdom was so profound and so obvious to all in attendance that Madison's notes reflect that there was no debate on the matter. And in fact, it was one of the few things adopted unanimously into the United States Constitution. The right for you and me, the sovereign citizen, acting through our sovereign states to get together and for two-thirds of us to call an amending convention. Now, once that convention is called, the way the process works is each state chooses to send delegates. And I get asked the question a lot is, how do the delegates get chosen by the states? You know, aren't we worried who will get chosen? And what I think is it gets chosen perfectly, which is in the Federalist manner. In other words, we are a federal system, and the states have the right to do as they choose in their sovereign capacity. So each state will choose how many delegates it wishes to send to the Constitution or to the convention, the amending convention. They might, if it's my crazy state of California, we might send 100 delegates representing this vast state and this very diverse population, right? And maybe Vermont, a small state, will choose to send a single delegate. It's hard to know, but what we do know is historically each state, one vote per state. So if California sends 100 delegates, whatever happens in that convention, they're all going to have to agree on what they're going to do, what their vote is going to be on any individual matter. So once they get into convention, the delegates decide, the first thing they decide is who presides over the convention. They'll name their officers. They'll choose a chairman or a president of the convention. History shows us that they'll do that. They'll choose a secretary of the convention. There's going to be some expenses. They'll probably choose a treasurer for the convention. So they're going to do all this stuff, make all these choices in the convention. And interestingly, right now, so that you guys know what's going on, we have something called the Assembly of State Legislatures going on right now. And these are legislators from all over the country that have gotten together. They've already met twice, as a matter of fact. Originally is what they called the Mount Vernon Assembly. They met at Mount Vernon historically, and then they met in Indianapolis. And in December, they're going to meet in Washington, D.C. And what they're doing is discussing, debating, and formalizing the rules for convention. Over 100 delegates have attended this Assembly of State Legislatures. Really incredible. These guys and these men and women, on their own dime, they've decided the convention's going to happen. It's for them, it's not if, it's when, and they're going on their own dime to draft the rules to remove any kind of uncertainty. And remember, simple majority controls the rules. Over 30 states have already attended, so they're going to have a majority. They're going to pre-adopt these rules is the hope. So when they go into convention, everybody will know exactly what the rules are going to be in convention. I think it's incredible that these people are already getting together, already doing this stuff. It shows you what the momentum is towards convention of states. So this is a real deal. You know, why do we need this? I mean, it seems like this big outrageous thing. We just are electing people and we get involved in politics. And, you know, if you're conservative, if you're a Republican, maybe you're excited by the results of the last election. You know, we did see the Senate switch hands. And so Republicans are in control of the Senate. Republicans got a bigger majority in the House. And interestingly, and more exciting to me, is we saw a move towards liberty-minded individuals arising in the state legislatures. The Republicans now control 30, maybe 31 state legislatures, depending on what happens in the Colorado House, both sides. That's a pretty extraordinary movement. But I got to say, I'm not a Republican. I haven't been a registered Republican for many, many years because I don't have any faith in either party. You know, when I look at what's gone on in Washington, D.C., if you're a conservative and you look back to the Reagan administration, you have to understand the administration grew government, unfortunately. You know, and this happens time after time, no matter who's in office, Democrat or Republican or split government. Government grows and the citizen becomes smaller. So if you're a conservative and you're really excited about what happened in this last election and you're looking at Congress and saying, wow, you know, the Republicans hold Congress, and maybe you even fantasize about a Republican taking the presidency. You know, I think about some liberty-minded individual winning the presidency in 2016. When I think about that, I have a vivid imagination, so you got to forgive me. I think about what it would be like to hear an oath of office that goes something like this. Imagine that the new president is stepping up to the podium after taking the oath of office. It's January of 2017, and that newly inaugurated president says something like this. Step up to the podium, and they say, ladies and gentlemen of the United States of America, my fellow citizens, we've reached a historic crossroads in American history. We've reached a time when the federal government has outgrown all bounds ever imagined by the founders. A time when the federal government and all three of its branches have outgrown all the chains and all the fetters placed upon them by the Constitution drafted by our framers. And because we've reached this time and it's such an extraordinary crossroads for the country, I, as the new president, dedicate myself and vow to you that I will spend the next 4 years working to do everything I can to make smaller the power of the presidency, to make smaller the power of the Supreme Court, and to make smaller the power of the Congress of the United States of America, to do all these things to return that power which we take away from those branches of government and return it to the sovereign citizen, thereby making the sovereign citizen larger. I think about that. It makes me smile to think about that. And then I smile even bigger because I think, that's a joke. No president is ever going to say that. We've never seen anybody in American history say that. We just have no right to believe that any president is going to say or do that. They're all going to continue on the path, some slower, some faster, but they're going to grow the American government. And so if that's the case, when we all want it to shrink and we all want government to get smaller, remember 60% of Americans today say that the federal government is too big. So if we all believe that electing Congress isn't enough, if we all believe that electing a president isn't enough, if we all believe that doing all these things and winning in all these ways means that we're going to continue to lose, why would we want to win to lose? How could that be enough? It's not enough. I mean, I can tell you for me it's not enough. I think about this and I don't smile anymore. When I think about that, when I think if we elect a president that has our values and a Congress that has our values, we're still going to lose our liberty, it makes me sad. I think about my kids. I have an 18-year-old son. He's enlisted in the United States Marines. He'll ship out in March. It's not enough for me to tell my son, Jacob, that, you know, when he's done with his service in the military, whether it's a career or it's a, you know, he has a single enlistment, when he's done, then I know we will have lost, and he will have lost more of his liberty. I can't look him in the eyes and say, that's all we could do. I have a daughter who's a sophomore in high school. She's just an awesome national class debater, a good, solid conservative surrounded by a bunch of very liberal people. She preaches her ideals. She talks about them. She knows how to debate them. It's not good enough for me to say to her, you know what, honey, you know, we did the best we could do. We knew that we would lose, but, you know, we just didn't do anything else. It's not enough. It's just not enough. There's got to be something more. And there is something more, and that something is Article 5. That's what the framers gave us for a time such as this. When the government outgrows its bounds, they told us this time would come and that we needed to use Article 5. You know, I told you I have kind of a wild imagination. Sometimes I'm sitting in my office here in the foothills late at night, got my feet up on my desk, and I'm thinking about what it would be like to sit around and talk to the founders. And you know, if I were talking to the founders and the framers right now, I have a feeling I might be a little bit whiny. I might complain about what the administration's doing and the liberties that are being taken away and how big the government's gotten and how small I feel as a citizen today. And I always picture Dr. Franklin, Benjamin Franklin, because he's a pretty cantankerous old guy, and I picture he'd be the first one to speak up because he wouldn't sit back in some kind of decorum and not want to say anything. He'd poke at me, and he would probably say, well, Mr. Meckler, tell me this. What have you done with Article 5? Have you and your fellow citizens used the tool we gave you in Article 5? Have you listened to the profound wisdom of George Mason like we did, and have you used Article 5? And I would have to sheepishly say, no, we haven't. I mean, there's people have talked about it, but some people are scared, and just everybody thought maybe it was too. And I think Franklin would just dismiss me. I think he would literally mock me, and he'd say, go away, young man. come back when you've used Article 5, and then you can bend our ear and tell us how it went, because we put it in there for you for such a time as this. So when I think about that conversation, I know how important it is for us to use Article 5. I know there's no other way to fix the country. Now let me give you another reason why Article 5 is so important. I hear a lot of people say, Mark, if we could just get people to follow the Constitution, everything would be okay. And you don't think really that they're going to follow amendments just because we amend the Constitution, do you? I mean, they're not following the Constitution now. And I probably would have said the same thing a year and a half ago before I talked to Mike Ferris. But I want you to step back and take a deep breath, because I'm going to say something that's probably going to surprise you, maybe even upset you a little bit. I'm going to tell you that mostly Congress and the President follow the Constitution. Now, I know that probably shocks you. It shocked me when I first heard it. It had to be explained to me. See, the thing is, in America today, we have two constitutions. Literally, we have the one that you and I know and love. I've got a copy of it up on my wall right here, a beautiful parchment copy of it. We love that constitution. We've all read it. We've studied it. We know it. It makes sense to us. The language is beautiful and eloquent and generally pretty simple. We get it. But the second constitution is that same constitution as interpreted by the United States Supreme Court, and especially as interpreted over the last 100 years. And it's extraordinary what they've done to that Constitution. Now remember, they're not alleging to have changed the Constitution at all. They say they're just interpreting the Constitution. Many people will tell you it's a living, breathing document to be interpreted with the times. And so they've made radical changes to that Constitution without changing a single word of it. And that's the Constitution under which we're forced to live. That's the modern-day rule set for America. That's the fundamental rule set. The Constitution, not as written, but as interpreted by the United States Supreme Court. Let me give you one of the simplest and most beautiful examples of this and how dramatically it's changed. You know, back in 1787, they had some significant differences between the colonies over trade. Literally, trade wars going on. And these folks, the framers, were worried that it was actually going to come to military blows between some of the states. And so they gave the federal government the enumerated power, the specific, limited, enumerated power to regulate interstate commerce. You know, if you ask anybody, I lecture to college students and to high school students all the time, I ask these classes, what's interstate mean? Everybody knows exactly what interstate means. It means between two states, right? Between the states. So it's pretty common sense. If you ask them what commerce means, all of us, everybody who's watching this, all these high school students I talk to, they all know what commerce means. It's generally something about business. It generally means business. And if you look it up, you're going to see a definition that means something like business, right? And so what they think when they read the Interstate Commerce Clause is that the founders, the framers, gave the federal government the power to deal with business that went between the states, any kind of business, and that's really broad. And a lot of the power of the federal government is based on this Interstate Commerce Clause. But if you look back to 1787, if you were able to get in that room with the framers who were drafting the Constitution and you asked them in 1787 parlance, what does commerce mean? They would have told you shipping. It was commonly known that commerce meant the shipment of goods. And so what were the framers trying to do when they crafted the Interstate Commerce Clause? They were trying to give the federal government a very narrow power, Congress, the narrow power to regulate the shipment of goods across state lines. So many regulations today in the United States, the federal government justifies under the umbrella of the Interstate Commerce Clause, thanks to the United States Supreme Court. You could make much of that go away, and frankly, much of the regulatory power of the federal government, if we simply, in an Article 5 amending convention, redrafted the Interstate Commerce Clause to read something like the power to regulate shipping of goods between the states. So there are many things like that now in the Constitution that have been interpreted very broadly by the United States Supreme Court, and we need to reset that rule set because, let's face it, Washington, D.C. is never going to do it for us. Their powers are way broader than the founders or the framers ever anticipated, and certainly so broad that they've made the citizens small in modern-day America. So we know we need to do it. Now the question is, can we do it? Is this the moment for us to do this in America? And I think if you look at the current political climate, the answer is yes. You know, you have to look at what kind of people are supporting this movement today. You know, if we looked at this movement 5 years ago, there were a few people talking about it, but it was pretty limited, pretty esoteric. I certainly didn't know anything about Article 5. If you'd asked me what Article 5 was, I would have had to look it up. I mean, I really couldn't have even told you. And I think this is true for most of America. Yet today, you have Mark Levin, the author of Liberty Amendments, a New York Times bestseller. He sold an incredible amount of copies on a book on this exact subject, using Article 5 to propose amendments to restrain the tyranny of the federal government in a structural way, a way that sits permanently in the Constitution. So you've got Levin, the intellectual leader of the movement, I would argue. In support of this movement today are Rush Limbaugh, Sean Hannity, Glenn Beck, Sarah Palin, Colonel Alan West. You've got Senator Ron Johnson, Senator Tom Coburn, 100-plus state legislators from all over the country. Governor Bobby Jindal just signed on. You've got Senator Mike Lee says he's in support of using Article 5. Senator Rand Paul says he's in support of using Article 5. It's extraordinary the breadth and depth of the movement today. You've got noted constitutional scholars and lawyers from around the country support the use of Article 5 nowadays. You've got Professor Robbie George at Princeton, Professor Randy Barnett at Georgetown University. You've got Chuck Cook, the primary outside constitutional litigator for the NRA, who was also inside working under Ed Meese in the Reagan administration. Mark Levin was right there as chief of staff in the Reagan administration. You've got presidential counsel C. Boyden Gray. I mean, it's incredible. The list goes on and on of all the luminaries, all the conservative intellectuals, all the conservative leaders saying that now, today, now, right now, is the time to use the Convention of States process found in Article 5. So today is the day. Now, we just had an election, so the question is, how did that election affect the Convention of States process? Well, you know, prior to the election, Convention of States, our project, we'd already passed the Convention of States application in Florida, Georgia, and Alaska. I mean, really incredible. Georgia was first, Florida and Alaska right behind, three big, giant states. Not easy to do it in big states with big legislatures, but we got it done in those, sort of a dry run at these first three states. We're moving forward in a lot of states. At least 21 states now have prime legislative sponsors for the 2015 legislative season. We still have one or two more we might be able to pass in 2014. We think we're going to have as many as 31 applications pending in the state legislatures by 2015. That's extraordinary. That means we actually have the opportunity to get to 34 states in 2015. I really think we can get it done. I'm really excited about that. It's way faster than I ever imagined possible. All the pieces of the puzzle are moving into place. All this public support, all the volunteers like you guys signing on, literally hundreds of thousands of people signing on, 200,000 people roughly on 50 state Facebook pages around the country, over 200,000 people on the Convention of States national Facebook page. You know, I'm going to remind you guys as we go through this call, if you want to participate, down on the bottom of this page, you can sign the petition. That petition will go to your state legislature. If you click on the button, it'll connect you with literally your legislator and ask them to call for the convention. If you click on the other button to be a volunteer, you can sign up. You can be a district captain. You can help make this happen because only you guys can make it happen. So the timing is perfect. And then we had these elections, and lo and behold, it got better. It's hard to believe it could have got better because things were going so well. Like so many in this country, I was holding my breath for these elections. Now, I was hopeful that the Republicans would take the Senate, but still, I don't hold out a lot of hope for Republicans generally. But what I saw in the states gave me more hope than I ever imagined possible. We saw an incredible turn in the state legislatures. We saw the state legislatures elect an additional somewhere around 360 Republicans. They turned over, and I don't think it's about parties here because, frankly, people don't like the Republicans too much either. So it's really not about Republicans versus Democrats. It's they're sick of big government. This is where the citizens are at. They're just sick and tired of centralized, big, controlling, abusive government. Right? They're tired of the NSA. They're tired of the EPA. They're tired of the IRS. They're tired of all these acronyms poking in and telling them what to do and controlling their life at every turn. And I think the reaction that we saw in this election was about local control. It was about returning the power to the people, taking it away from centralized government, not only at the federal level, but at the state level. But because of this giant wave that swept the electoral landscape, we now have 31 states that are controlled by Republican majorities in both houses. And that means those are places where we're likely to be able to get this done. Now, I want to be clear, this is not a Republican movement. It's not. This is for Republicans and Democrats. It's for liberals and conservatives. And why do I say that? Some people who are conservatives get mad at me when I say that. But here's the way I look at it. What I really want in each state, in each community, is I want the people in charge. You know, unfortunately for me, I live in California, and that means liberals will be in charge. We're going to have to fight that fight on the ground in California. But if I have my choice of having power reside at the federal level, regardless of who the administration is or who Congress is, or have power reside here at home in my own state, I'm going to choose for the power and the money and the decision-making capacity to be here at home. I say to some of my liberal friends in states like New York or Massachusetts that whether they're liberal or conservative, I would fight and die for their rights to make the decisions at home. The fundamental question facing America today is not what should we do. We have all these weird fights about Obamacare versus free market healthcare, or this much EPA regulation versus that much EPA regulation. I think those are the wrong fights. Those fights contain an underlying premise, and that premise is that the decisions get made in Washington, D.C. And you know, when they get made in D.C., whether you're liberal or conservative, you lose. The people lose. There is a vast conspiracy. It's neither right or left wing. It's a vast conspiracy to keep the power in D.C. and to keep it out of your hands, the people's hands, right? We heard recently Gruber saying over and over in the media how stupid the American people are. The amazing thing about Gruber's comments isn't that he said them. It's how many people in government today believe that way. So we have to take the power back, and we have to return it to the people. So I've explained to you how a convention of states works, how we get into convention, why we need a convention, why this is the moment for convention, specifically right now, today, is the moment for convention. And I've explained to you how the process works. Now let's talk a little bit about what happens after you come out of convention. So by simple majority, the people in that convention are going to vote out a slate of amendments. Is it one? Is it five? Is it 10? We don't know. What kind of amendments will come out? I'm really excited by some of them. You know, I can tell you Americans today support term limits for Congress by a margin of about 80%. 80% of Americans say that they think we should have term limits for Congress. We the people tried to do this. We passed it in 23 states by ballot proposition or initiative. And then the Supreme Court told us, you're not allowed to do that. You can't limit your own congressional delegation. Can you imagine? The people vote for it, they pass it in 23 states, and the Supreme Court says no. Well, we can say yes, because we can get term limits out of an Article 5 amending convention. And in fact, U.S. term limits, the largest and oldest term limits organization in the United States of America, the organization that passed those 23 term limits initiatives, they endorse the Convention of States Project because they know this is the only way we get federal term limits. So you could get that. I think that would come out of convention. You can also get a balanced budget amendment out of convention. You know, extraordinarily, you and me and everybody else in this country, we have to balance our budgets. If we have more money going out than coming in, eventually we go bankrupt. We can't just print money. By necessity, we have to face reality. We have to balance our budgets. The majority of states have balanced budgets in place, balanced budget amendments to their constitution or some form of legislation. The United States government does not. And it's always resisted. It's always resisted. Congress has never done it, and they're not going to do it to themselves. They're not going to say to you, the American people, hey, we're not going to spend any more money. We're going to put some kind of statutory cap on it. The only way we're going to get that done is if we, the people, do it. You know, at one point in our history, we got to 32 states that had called for an Article 5 convention on the balanced budget amendment. Really close. We only needed 34, right? And there were some organizations, including Eagle Forum and the AFL-CIO, that went out there and got people scared that this was going to be some crazy runaway thing, and they stopped us from getting to that convention. You know, when I look back at that, I think about the missed opportunity. It's extraordinary. Our debt at the time was around $1.7 trillion. Today we're almost $28 trillion. We're going to hit $28 trillion any moment, maybe while I'm speaking. So to those who fought against it back then, so long ago, back in the 80s, the early to mid 80s, and they fought against a balanced budget amendment because they were scared about it, we have them to thank for an additional, say, $26 trillion roughly in debt. $26 trillion on your back and my back and our children's back and our grandchildren's back. I don't know how we're ever going to pay that money back. But we have the people who fought against the balanced budget amendment in Article 5 back then, so many years ago, to thank for that, at least partially. So we've got to do it now. Now is the time. So once we get this slate out, let's say it includes a balanced budget amendment, it includes term limits, maybe it includes a single subject amendment that says Congress can't put together these huge bills that contain all this different stuff, this big mishmash. People are forced to vote for things they like in order to, and they get things they don't like along with it, and vice versa. What if we do a single subject amendment? I mean, I love that one. No bill contains anything more than a single subject. How about what we call a regulatory freedom amendment that says Congress has to go on record on regulation? If they pass regulation that has more than $100 million effect on the economy, then they have to vote on it. They can't just off that on some bureaucrats and then claim they don't know what happened, because that's what they do all the time. So all of these things are likely to come out. And if you want to get to some of the broader, maybe more extreme things, how about a repeal of the 16th Amendment, the direct income tax? The founders never intended for us to pay income tax directly to the federal government. They didn't want that kind of financial relationship between us and the federal government. We could remit the monies to the state, and then the states could negotiate and deal with the federal government on the taxes to be paid by the states to the federal government. Now, I want to be clear, Convention of States, our project isn't promoting one or any or all of those amendments. We don't know exactly what amendments will come out of a convention. What we've done is we've limited the convention by subject matter. We've limited what could be germane in a convention, because if you look on our website, you can see all the information right there. What it'll tell you is that anything that would impose fiscal restraints on the federal government is germane. Of course, a balanced budget amendment falls under there. Anything that would limit the scope or the power or the jurisdiction of the federal government fits in there. So anything that you could think would constrict the federal government is germane in a convention. And last but not least, anything that would impose term limits on federal officials is germane in a convention. So all of these things would be germane, but the convention is actually limited to those things. So by its own nature, it's prevented from running away. By the application status, by the commissions that each delegate carries with them to the convention, saying what their authority is, it's limited. You know, once in a while I hear people talk about a runaway convention. And, you know, it used to frustrate me when I heard this talk because I thought it was so irrational. Now I just kind of laugh and smile at it, because really the debate's been had and won. And I want to simply address this as easily and in the most common sense way I can. When people talk to me about a runaway convention, I ask them, can they do math? And of course, everybody can do math. It doesn't take complicated math to do this. You don't have to be an algebra expert. You just have to know that it takes 3/4 of states to approve any amendment that comes out of convention. Today, that's 38 states in America. And so anything that comes out of that convention, whether it's really rational and reasonable or some really crazy idea that we might disagree with, has to be approved by 38 states, and really both houses of the legislature in 38 states. So what happens if something crazy comes out of that convention? It goes out to the states. Remember, you do the math the opposite way, too. It means it only takes 13 states, and really, because it'll probably be being approved by state legislatures, only one house in each of 13 states to stop anything crazy. So if you look at the math, do you really believe that we can't stop something in 13 states? And I want you to think about this, again, doing more math. The conservative self-identification advantage in those 13 most conservative states in America, people who say I'm conservative versus I'm progressive or liberal, it runs from between 27 to 38% roughly. What that means is between 27 and 38% more people say that they're conservatives than are liberal or progressive. So if you're worried about some crazy idea coming out, and that it's going to be some very crazy liberal or left idea that you might not like personally, understand that we can beat it easily in 13 states. By the way, the 13 most conservative states in America don't include states like Texas, Kansas, states that you and me traditionally think of as very conservative. So I ask you, with the army that's on this video chat right now, with Mark Levin and Sean Hannity and Glenn Beck and Rush Limbaugh and Sarah Palin, all the other talkers in the country, with all the politicians that we have that wouldn't want something bad to happen in America from a constitutional perspective, it's obvious we can stop anything that we think that we don't like. And that's really important, because if we don't believe that, if anybody really believes that we can't stop something in 13 states and stop it from being ratified, then I'd have to ask that person, why are you even fighting? If you really believe that the country is that far gone, then you should really retire from politics. You know, what I would do is I would just retire. I would cocoon with my family. I'd pray to the Lord for mercy in the dark days to come. But I don't even begin to believe that that's where the country's at. You guys are out there. Incredible people all over the country out there. This rising tide of people who are frustrated and fed up with big government. That's what the real America looks like. I don't worry about it. I'm not hopeful about it. I'm absolutely sure of where we're headed. Where we're headed is to a convention. Maybe, possibly, I think even probably at this point, we can get to that convention in 2015, and we can call it in 2016. Imagine how exciting that would be. A convention of states being held during a presidential election year. I would love to hear the moderators, remember we're going to have some decent moderators this time around, ask the presidential candidates a very simple question. Do you believe that the citizens of this great country should convene to decide the appropriate size, scope, power, and jurisdiction of the federal government? What a question. And the people who say, yes, I believe that, and the people who elaborate on that and explain what they think the appropriate size, scope, and jurisdiction of the federal government should be, those are the people that I'm going to be supporting for president in 2016. I can just about guarantee you this is going to be a presidential election discussion. Is it going to be asked about in the debates? I don't know. But we've got a lot of candidates poking around the edge, people who are potential candidates poking around the edge of Convention of States. You know, we've got Governor Huckabee, who's been a direct endorser of Convention of States. A lot of supporters of Convention of States out there looking at running for president. So it's going to be an issue. It's going to take you guys. It's going to take you reaching down right now, clicking that button after this is over, saying that you want to volunteer. That's the most important thing you can do. It's not about me. It's not about Mike Ferris. It's not even about the politicians anymore. We're way beyond that. It's about you, the citizens. You got to ask yourself a question. Are you going to sit back and let this country slide into the abyss, or are you going to stand and fight? I want to close with this. I want to tell you a story about the American Revolution. It's my favorite story from the American Revolution. When we study American history in this country, if you went to public schools, and look, you got to forgive me, I grew up in Los Angeles, so I went to some of the worst public schools in America, in my opinion. And we learned American history in this certain way, but I found that kids learn this all over the country. You learn about, first, about the Pilgrims. You learn about the Mayflower and Jamestown, the Mayflower Compact, right? And then the next big event in American history, generally, that you learn about is the American Revolution. There's this incredible period in between there. You know, most people don't know how long that was. When I first got asked, I had no idea what's the period between the American Revolution, say the Mayflower Compact, Jamestown, and the American Revolution. How many years? And I had no idea when I first got asked. I mean, wild guess, I thought, I have 75 years, 50. I just didn't know. I'd never even heard about this period, right? Never been taught anything about it. Well, if you look at the history books, it's roughly 158 years. Five generations of people. An extraordinary amount of time. What was going on during that period of time in American history? There's a story that's told by a historian by the name of Mellon Chamberlain that I think sums it up really well. And in 1843, Chamberlain was traveling around the country. He was a young school teacher. He was a self-taught historian. And he was collecting the stories of the last remaining Minutemen, the guys who actually fought in the American Revolution. In 1843, they were old, right? They were in their late 80s and early 90s, and nowadays we got guys that age and women that age going strong, but back then, I mean, that was ancient. Average life expectancy was 54 years, so to find people in their late 80s, early 90s, not a lot of them left. Chamberlain knew that he had to collect these stories or they would disappear forever. He knew that he had to get these oral histories. Remember, I'm coming to you today right on Google Hangouts. We had no Google Hangouts, no YouTube, no tape recorders, no video cameras, no nothing except for his notes. So he was meeting with these guys all over the country. And he happened to cross the path of one Captain Levi Preston in North Carolina in 1843. Preston, who had been there at the battles of Lexington and Concord. And he asks Preston a series of questions about why he participated. He wants to know. Now, to put it in context, you got to remember, it's kind of like they were being asked to go fight the Redcoats, right? The greatest fighting force ever assembled in modern history. The most well-fed, the most well-trained, the most well-funded, I mean, an incredible fighting force, right? And they were being asked, farmers, merchants, to go fight them, to pick up the arms that they had and to go out into the field of battle. It's kind of like if I was coming to you today saying, hey, the Marines are coming to town and we should all go out and pick a fight with the Marines. So he wanted to know what inspired men to fight this fight. And he asks Levi Preston about the Stamp Act. And he said, was it the stamps? Were you offended that you had to put these stamps on all your documents and that was such outrageous tyranny, you had to object to it and come out to fight it? And he said, Preston says something like, the stamps, I never saw one of them. I heard they were locked up in the armory, but I'm certain I never bought a one of them. So he asks him about the tax on tea, and he says, was it the outrageous tax on tea? It was unbelievable, the tyranny of the British to impose a tax on the primary beverage of the colonies like this. And Preston says, I never drank a drop of it. We heard the boys dropped it all in the harbor, but that was the last we ever heard of it. So he's starting to run out of avenues. He asks him, was it the great revolutionaries? Were you reading Milton and Burke and the other revolutionaries? And he said, what we read was the Bible, Catechism, Psalms, and the Almanac. Those guys you mentioned, never heard of them. So he goes big and broad, and he asks one final question. He asks him, was it the heavy hand of British tyranny? Were you just fed up with British tyranny and the oppression? And he said, I never felt a whit of it. So then he says, well, what was it? What brought you out to the battle that day? You had everything to risk. You were a 23-year-old farmer. You had a wife and kids. You're not a soldier, and you went out and risked it all against the Redcoats that day. What brought you to the field of battle? And I think this is where Preston sums up American revolutionary history at its best. He says, well, son, when we went on the battlefield that day to face them Redcoats, we meant only one thing. We had always governed ourselves, and we always intended to. And them Redcoats, they intended that we shouldn't. I think that's extraordinary. I think that sums up who we were as Americans at the time of the American Revolution. We were a free people fighting to retain our freedom. An unusual revolution. Not slaves fighting to be free. Five generations of free, self-governing people fighting to retain that freedom, that liberty to be a self-governing people. And I think, I believe from traveling this country for the last 6 years, that's exactly where we are today. We're a free people. We're a people who believe that when you ask the question, who decides, the only appropriate answer is, I decide. My family decides. The free market decides. Private enterprise decides. My church decides. My community decides. Maybe my city or my county decides. And in rare instances, maybe we've got to say my state decides. And in a very limited slice of well-enumerated scenarios, the federal government decides. But mostly, I, as the individual, am the sovereign citizen here in America. That's what Levi Preston was saying. It's all he knew after five generations. Unfortunately, we've been on a slow, gradual slope away from that for all these decades. And recently that slope has been escalated. And today I would argue it's kind of like the proverbial frog in the pot of boiling water, right? It was warm, it was kind of like a jacuzzi, but in this last administration it's got turned up to a full boil. And a lot of us have jumped out of that pot and said, whoa, we're not taking this anymore, right? I got to do something. What do? We said we're going to be Tea Partiers. We're going to protest. We're going to go to rallies. We're going to call our congressmen. We're going to elect some people. And we did all those things, and we did them in spades. It was incredible what happened. And then we got not much change. A lot of the same. And now a lot of people are asking the question. You might be asking yourself the question. I had to ask myself the question, what do we do? If electing people isn't enough to preserve this sense of self-governance, if it's not enough to leave us where we want to be, which is a self-governing people, what do we do? And the only answer that I know, the only answer that anybody has ever suggested to me beyond elect good people, which we all know doesn't work, the only answer given to us by the founders in the United States Constitution is found in the second clause of Article 5, where you, I believe, are not only given the right to, but imposed upon you the moral obligation to call an Article 5 amending convention to restrain the tyranny of the federal government. And that's where we are today. That's why you're on this video hangout with me. Because you believe this, because you're in, because you're willing to fight. So I'm going to close with this before we go to questions. If you haven't signed up yet, if you haven't signed the petition to at least tell your state legislator they need to call a convention, after this is over, click that button, sign the petition, go straight to your state legislator. It's going to send the message to them loud and strong. It's what we need to get them to call the convention. We got to get them to do it. They are the mechanism, and they will act if you put the pressure on. And then if you're willing to step up just a little bit more, just a little bit, then I'm going to ask you to be a volunteer. Click that button and be a volunteer. It doesn't take that much. We're not looking for a lot of your time. We're not looking for a huge commitment. Just help us get organized. Help us organize your friends, your neighbors, your fellow employees, your fellow church members to do the right thing, to do what the founders expect of us, and to do what our children and our grandchildren and our posterity expect of us, and that is to use every tool at our disposal, every tool the founders gave us in this incredible, divinely inspired nation, and that includes the tool given to us in Article 5 to call a convention to propose amendments to the United States Constitution. So God bless you guys for being here tonight. Thank you for being involved, for those of you who've already signed up. Thank you to those that are going to press that button to volunteer, press that button to sign the petition. I'm telling you, we're in. The staff at Convention of States is in. I'm in all the way as long as it takes. Mike Ferris is in. I know I can tell you that for him here tonight. We'll have him come to you in one of these chats soon. So what I'm going to do now, you got to give me a little break here because I'm doing this all by myself here from my home office. I'm going to start looking at some of the questions that have come in. So give me a couple seconds. I'm going to look. I'm going to put my glasses on here. I'm going to start to look at some of those questions, and I'm going to answer some of the questions that have come in. So just give me a few seconds here. Maybe you grab a cup of water. I'll grab a sip of my coffee here, and we'll look at some of these questions. Okay, so I'm looking at questions. So, you know, one of the questions is, and I'm guessing I'm going to see this question over and over as I go through here. One of the questions is, do both houses need to pass and have the governor sign in order for the application to be approved? And the answer is, the governor's not involved. Both houses have to pass by a simple majority. We've got one state in the country, Nebraska, that's a unicameral legislature, so only one house has to pass it. But it's both houses, simple majority. That's one of the reasons it's so important now that we have 31 houses where both houses are controlled by Republicans. Here, for those of you that are out there that are in Nevada, extraordinarily, Nevada just switched both houses from Democrat to Republican, so we've got a pickup opportunity there. So the short answer, no, governors are not involved. Question is, will there be a central clearinghouse? This is from David Seffrin. Will there be a central clearinghouse to ensure proper aggregation of applications from the states for a convention to propose amendments? We're tracking all of them. We actually have legislative staff, lawyers in our employ who work in our office in Percival, Virginia, who are tracking every application. So we won't wait for Congress to say that the applications aggregate. We'll call aggregation as soon as we hit 34. We're watching them. All applications being passed have the same exact language on them, so we know we're not going to have any aggregation difficulty. The question is a PR campaign envisioned to thwart opponents to refute claims of a runaway convention, for example? This is from Matthew Ostrander. Thanks, Matt, for the question. And the answer is, yeah, there is a PR campaign. You know, one of the things that we have an advantage of ours is without paying PR, we have Mark Levin and Sean Hannity and Rush Limbaugh and Glenn Beck and all these people out there who are speaking the truth about Article 5. And so we will have also a paid, coordinated PR campaign when the time comes for that push. The best PR campaign comes, though, from you guys, really, from having the knowledge to give that example I gave about the 38 states, from understanding that the application limits the scope of the convention, but primarily that you've got this fail-safe on the back end that it only takes one house in 13 states to stop anything we don't like. So that was a great question, Matthew. I appreciate that. Let's take a look here. Next one, let's see. Is there an urgency getting this completed within the next 2 years given the significant majorities held by Republicans in state legislatures? And I would say that the answer is, yeah, there's a sense of urgency. You know, there's a sense of urgency to me just because I think the country is slipping away. So I'm not happy to wait for any of this. You know, I'm a now guy. We've got to get this done now. And now, with the recent turn in the legislative majorities in so many states, we have an opportunity. Now, I'm a momentum guy, and if you look at when you have momentum, that's the time when you double down, right? So when you have momentum, it becomes easier to push an object. If you've ever been stalled out in your car, maybe some of your buddies helped you start pushing the car gets rolling faster and faster. Faster it rolls, the easier it is to push it. But as it gets going fast, you kind of get this temptation to jump in the car and just ride the momentum. That's the lazy way. And if you do that, what happens is the momentum will slow and it will bleed off real quickly and then the car will stop moving. And so instead, when you have momentum, you push harder and harder and faster and faster. I can tell you that's what I'm doing right now post-election. That's what our staff is doing at the Convention of States office. And we're all working twice, three times as hard. We didn't think we could do that. We're so invigorated by the task at hand that that is actually what we're doing right now. So now is the time to take advantage of the momentum. I'm going to scroll down, look at a few more questions here. Let's see what we've got. Here's a question. Why hasn't Heritage Foundation gotten on board? I told them I was dropping my support until they did. Should Dement debate Levin? So I would say it's really important if you guys are supporters of Heritage like I am. I think Heritage does an incredible amount of great work, especially with Heritage Action in place where they're actually taking action, pushing for particular things. I think they are going to come on board. I just think it takes time. You know, they're a big multi-million-dollar organization. They're not quick and nimble. That's not what they're designed to do. They're very thoughtful. Remember, they're based in a think tank. I had the very great privilege of sitting next to one of their lead lawyers at the Federalist Society dinner just a few days ago. They're very interested in what we're doing. Mike Ferris was there not too long ago, a couple of months ago, making a presentation. But again, it's grassroots. So I think the best way to get somebody like Heritage to support what we're doing is for those of you who support Heritage to call or write Heritage and say, hey, when are you going to be supporting Convention of States? And it's really important that they say Convention of States, not just Article 5 generally. You know, I'm looking at the next question. The next question I see from Steve is a question about what's the difference between Convention of States, or I hear people pushing just a balanced budget amendment, or there's something called Compact for America floating around there, which he says he doesn't understand. So let me explain the difference real quickly. You know, generally speaking, I'm a fan of a balanced budget amendment. I mean, there's some debate about whether it's a good thing or not, but look, the American people want it. They want it by, you know, 75-80% margin. So the question is, why not just support a balanced budget amendment? Why not promote that and get to an Article 5 convention on just balanced budget? And here's why. I don't know about you, but I don't believe that fixes the problems that ail the nation. It's not enough. We've got a lot of problems ailing the nation. I described a bunch of them for you. Definitional problems in the Constitution itself based on what the Supreme Court's done. So if we get to an Article 5 convention and the only subject is a balanced budget amendment, even if we get a balanced budget amendment, we've got to start all over again, because that's not going to fix the problem. It is not a solution as big as the problem. Only Convention of States getting in there, dealing with a balanced budget, dealing with term limits, dealing with single subject, dealing with the Commerce Clause, all these things that ail the country, only Convention of States is a solution as big as the problem. That's why I support the Convention of States initiative over any other Article 5 initiatives out there. It is the unifying initiative. You know, we hear all the time that people get frustrated because the conservative movement is divided, right? The only Article 5 approach that unites everybody is the Convention of States approach, because you can get a balanced budget amendment. You can bring the term limits folks in and get term limits under the Convention of States approach. So it's the only approach that unifies the entire conservative movement around a way to get at all these issues. Here, we're going to go ahead and scroll down, look at some more questions here. So here's a question from Bob Champion. The question is, how do I encourage petition signers who are hesitant to take a second step? In other words, these are people that have gone ahead, they're doing what I've asked all of you to do, make sure you sign that petition. And now Bob's asking, how do we get them to take the next step and really volunteer and get involved? And I would say it's through relationship. It's through what I do every day, which is I'm out talking to people about Convention of States. I'm explaining to them why this is the only way, and I'm explaining to them, importantly, why they matter. You know, in this country right now, so many people believe that they can't make a difference. And they're used to maybe clicking on a petition and thinking, well, that's all I can do. And maybe if we're lucky, they vote. Not enough of them vote. But maybe if we're lucky, they vote and they think, you know, I've checked the box, I voted, I've clicked the petition. We need to let them know that they need to do more. Generations of people have done a lot more. People have stood up, the founders stood up, and they signed the Declaration of Independence, put their families and their lives on the line. They said that they were pledging their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor, and they backed that up with action. We have generations of men and women that have gone overseas and fought for the freedoms and liberties that we have. We've taken a constitutional oath to protect the Constitution from enemies, both external and domestic, right? And we have domestic problems right now, domestic enemies to our freedom and our liberty. And so I would talk to them about the fact that if not them, who? And if not now, when? You know, these were Reagan phrases, right? And I would let them know, it doesn't take a lot to be a hero. One of my favorite Reagan quotes is that they say we live in a time when there are no heroes. They just don't know where to look. When I'm looking into this camera, I'm looking out at thousands of heroes, 3,000 plus heroes from all around the country who are willing to step up and spend some of their time in this fight. So I would promote the idea that they have an obligation to their country to do something heroic. And being engaged in the Convention of States and calling for a convention is something heroic. So I'm going to scroll down a little bit more. So one of the questions is, what support can district captains expect? And so I think the most important thing that you can do is be communicating directly with your state director, because those are the people that can give you the support. And so what they ought to be doing is give you ideas of how to recruit more people and get more people into your district. Remember, you need 100 people in your district. They ought to be helping you understand how Facebook is used for this purpose. They ought to be, you know, if you want to, they ought to be dialoguing with you about how to talk to people. You know, one of the things, my favorite things to do is get on the phone with people and role play with them. You know, how do I talk to people about Convention of States? What if somebody says X? What if they say Y? And I practice with people. I do this all the time at the national level. I'm dealing with people who have to go in the media and answer these questions. I'm talking to state directors or legislative liaisons as I travel around the country. I'm helping them answer these questions. So really, the biggest thing, the biggest support that we can give you is to teach you how to be confident in your approach to people. But remember, it's a person-to-person deal. More than anything else, this is about relationships. It's about who are you willing to talk to in your church, in your place of work, in your family. And we can help you on the web as well, but I've always believed in the power of person-to-person. It's only individuals that can save America. They're the only ones who ever have. Let's see. So question is, are we going to make a powerful audio-visual tool, this is John Murray, available that's much more than just a text-bound PowerPoint? You know, I think we're doing that with a series of videos. We've got a good series of videos developing. Mike Ferris and I are both working on new video series that we're going to be putting up. Both of us just had HD television and studios installed on a bi-coastal basis. I've got one here in California. He's got one there in Virginia. So we're going to be recording a series of videos. Hopefully the video that you've seen tonight is really helpful to you, because probably as of tomorrow that will be available on the on our page, on the conventionofstates.com webpage. So instead of having to explain all these things yourself, you can send somebody to look at the video and, you know, say, hey, maybe this guy Mark Meckler explained it better than you feel like you can. You don't have to explain it like that. Just show the video to people. So we will have more and more audiovisual tools for you guys. Let's see here. So the question is, do your old contacts, this is from Jeff Hogan, do your old contacts in TPP agree on the need for COS? Will they support us? You know, I think Tea Party Patriots is like a lot of large organizations. They tend to support their own causes. I would say the majority of people that I talk to within Tea Party Patriots are in support. The organization itself has never come out and taken a stand for or against a Convention of States project. I would say my position would be it's a lot like Heritage, which means it's going to take you guys, grassroots members of Tea Party Patriots, to encourage them to actually take the step to support it, because they should be listening to you. It's really what their role is, right? Their job is not to lead the grassroots. Their job is to listen to the grassroots. So at the time that they're getting enough pressure from you guys, Tea Party Patriots or any other organization, to step up and get involved, that's when I believe they'll get involved. So it's really not for me to convince them or anybody at a quote-unquote national leadership level. If they're doing their job, they're doing it on a grassroots basis, they're going to listen to you, not me. Okay, let's see. You know, I feel like looking at these, I'm seeing a lot of duplicate questions here. Let me see. So we've answered most of them. Here's a question, let's see, sorry guys, I'm bouncing around a little bit on the questions here. Here's a question from Jeff Hogan on techniques, and he asks, what are some of the best techniques to get this initiative to resonate with citizens and to get our state legislatures moving? What have you seen work? And so, you know, one of the things I learn when I'm on the road so much. If, you know, people think I go on the road and I'm talking a lot, and I do have to do that, I'd rather be listening, because every time I go out, I learn. I was in Missouri recently. We have an incredible state leadership team in Missouri, as we do, frankly, in all the states where leaders are working. Missouri, I learned a lot, and I learned something from the Speaker of the House there. You know, I was talking to the Speaker, and we went out to breakfast, and he said he was totally in support of Convention of States, and we were telling him the hows and whys and the wherefores. And he stopped me and he said, you know what, Mark, most of that stuff you're talking about is way too complicated for your average state legislator. And he said, you know, if they ask you questions about this stuff, yeah, you should use it. But he gave me a technique that I think is way better than anything I've ever come up with myself. And he said this, when you're talking to a state legislator, he said, this is what I'm going to ask my fellow legislators. I'm going to ask them, are you in favor of the federal government being forced to balance its budget, and are you in favor of term limits on members of Congress? Because if so, you're in favor of the Convention of States initiative, and if not, then you're against it, and you should probably let your constituents know that you're against term limits in a balanced budget amendment. And that was just simple and profound and to the point. And he said, there are going to be very few state legislators that are going to be willing to openly say they're against term limits and balanced budget. They're not going to say, they may say it among themselves, but they're not going to say it to their constituents because they have to support those things. They know the public supports those things. So it's a real simple pitch for state legislatures. And then another way of pitching it to the state legislatures, which I think is really good, really important, is it's in their best interest. Here's what we're saying to a state legislator, in essence. I'm saying, Mr. State Legislator, as between you and the federal government, I trust you. Whether you're on the left or you're on the right, you're the one I trust. And what I want is I want to make sure that you have the majority of the power and the money and the authority to work on behalf of your constituents in your state, regardless of what party's in charge. If there's a fight in a state legislature, in a state, I'm going to be honest. You know, if I'm in a state legislature and there's Democrats and Republicans, I'm neither, but most likely, philosophically, I'm going to come down with the Republicans most of the time. I don't love them a whole lot more than I love the Democrats, but philosophically, they're probably just slightly more closely aligned with me. But when that fight is, and there's an aisleway dividing the state from Washington, D.C., I'm on the side of the state. I'm on the side of New York State, no matter how liberal I might think it is, right? If people in New York want to be really liberal and have really liberal programs, then I think they should keep their money in state. They should keep the authority and the power to make those decisions in state. And I support them in doing that. So whether I'm talking to somebody on the left or the right, the issue is not about left or right. The issue is about where does power reside. And I think most Americans agree that power should reside at home, closer to them. So those are some of the techniques that I use for working with people on both sides of the aisle. So I think I'm going to close with that. We've had a nice long call here, guys. We've gone for just over an hour. I intended to limit it to an hour. I really appreciate you guys being here and participating. I appreciate your patience with this, our first ever on-air Google Hangout. It's been interesting for me. I got to tell you, there's one thing I don't like about it. That is that I really like being with you guys. My favorite thing to do is to be out in the field working with the grassroots. This is why I travel so much. In fact, tomorrow I'm headed off for a few days in Alabama to be with our Alabama team, do some great work with grassroots and legislators there in Alabama. I love that kind of stuff. I was in Missouri not long ago. I get to travel around the country, meet you guys, learn from you guys, be inspired by you guys. So the only thing I don't like about this hangout thing is I'm sitting here in a room by myself talking to a little green dot on the top of my computer. I appreciate you guys who put the questions in so that I know you're really out there. I'm not just talking to myself. And I'm going to take satisfaction and go to sleep tonight knowing hopefully you guys are out there and you're sending good wishes my way. If you guys have comments about this webcast, I'd really appreciate if you send them in to our staff at conventionofstates.com. Let us know how we can make it better, more interesting, more exciting, more interactive for you guys. Because this is just the first. This is experimental. If you guys liked it, if you found it helpful, if you want to suggest topics, particular times we should do it, ways we should do it, you guys drive the movement. Now, I mean this from the bottom of my heart. People ask all the time, where's George Washington today when we need him, right? You know, where's the Madison? Where's Sam Adams? My response is, well, you know, those guys are out there. They're everywhere. I meet them among you guys when I travel around the country. Sometimes people don't believe me, but I meet Sam Adams all the time. I meet the rebel rouser. I meet the great orators, the Patrick Henrys. I meet the great leaders in states. I meet them all the time. But those aren't the guys that we need the most. The guys that we need the most are Levi Preston. That's all I am. I'm just an average guy sitting here in my barn in Northern California. That's what won the American Revolution. That's who you guys are. Most of the people I meet out there, most of the people are Levi Preston. They're self-governing people. You've always governed yourselves, and you always intend to, and I know that you guys will fight for it. That's why I'm so privileged to be working with you guys. So I want to thank you for your support for Convention of States. God bless you guys. God bless America. Thanks a lot, guys.